Chapter 7, Spanish Settlements. The expeditions of De Soto and Coronado showed that the age of the conquistadors was ending. Both men had hoped to find fabulous riches and outdo the achievements of Cortes and Pizarro. Both the expeditions of De Soto and Coronado ended unsuccessfully. Both found little gold. De Soto didn't even make it home. Coronado did, but he came home beaten down and demoralized because he lost the large investment he made in the expedition to find wealth. The Spaniards decided that there was no gold to be found in the parts of the North American mainland De Soto and Coronado had explored. They began to focus their attention on the colonies they had already established farther south in the Caribbean, Mexico, and South America. However, they did not forget about the rest of North America entirely. They established a few forts to protect their colonies and ships, and they sent some missionaries to convert the Native Americans to Christianity. In the 1560s, the French had begun exploring the eastern coast of Florida. They set up a fort named Fort Caroline. Some men from the fort became pirates. They started attacking Spanish ships sailing in the Caribbean. The Spanish decided to build their own fort along the coast of Florida to protect their ships and to keep the French from competing in that part of North America. They sent a man named Pedro Menendez de Aviles to set up the fort. He arrived in August of 1565 and found a safe harbor where a river flowed into the Atlantic Ocean to build the fort and named it St. Augustine after a Christian saint. Soon after, the Spanish attacked and captured the French fort, Fort Caroline, and renamed it San Mateo. St. Augustine, Florida, was established in 1565, 20 years before the English settlement on Roanoke Island, and 42 years before the settlement at Jamestown. There have been people living there ever since. In fact, St. Augustine is the oldest continuously inhabited European settlement in the continental United States. The Spanish also sent missionaries who worked to convert the native people to Christianity. The missionaries set up communities called missions. Pedro Menendez, the first Spanish colonial governor of Florida, was an important influence in having missionaries brought to North America. Menendez insisted that any ships coming from Spain must include a priest who could serve as a missionary. The Spanish set up a number of missions in the 1570s in Florida and on the islands off the coast of what is today the state of Georgia. Spanish missions were also established in Mexico, near the border of what we now know as the United States. In the 1590s, the Spanish began establishing missions in what is known as the Southwest, including states we now call New Mexico, Arizona, and Texas. In the 1700s, the Spanish built many missions along the Pacific coast of California. The Spanish did this not only to convert the natives to Christianity, but also to develop allies among the converted people in North America. Many American cities in the Southwest began as missions named after Christian saints. Some examples include San Diego, San Francisco, San Jose, and Santa Barbara in California, and San Antonio in Texas. Every mission centered around a church. Missionaries would often live in one building, and the converted Native Americans would live within the mission in their own houses. Most missions also included farms and orchards. Some natives were also taught crafts such as carpentry, woodworking, weaving, soap making, and candle making. They also raised cattle, sheep, and other animals. Most missions also had bakeries, craft shops, and storerooms for the crops grown on the farms and orchards. In the missions, the native peoples attended a school where they received instruction from priests who included religious teachings. They were taught about Christianity and the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Adults and older siblings would also work in the mission's farms or orchards, while young children were taught to read, write, and speak in Spanish, not their native language. Some missionaries and conquistadors shared some similarities, but also had differences. Most missionaries were not trying to conquer people using force. Some were, however, trying to change the natives' ways of life and promote Christianity and European ways of living. That meant some missionaries were trying to extinguish the natives' traditional religion, culture, and language because they believed that it would be more helpful to them. Similar to conquistadors, some of the missionaries made enslaved the natives and forced them to work on the farms. Many local native populations also suffered the same fate as those who had first encountered Columbus. They became infected and died of diseases to which many of the Spanish had become immune. Some Native Americans accepted Christianity and lived in the local missions. Many others did not like being forced to adopt the new European way of life and the Christian religion. They wanted to keep their language, their religion, and their traditional ways of life. Eventually, some Native people rebelled against the missions in their areas. In 1680, a Native American from the Tewa Pueblo tribe named Pope successfully led a rebellion that evicted the Spanish from their pueblos. Once they regained control, the tribe restored their own religion, culture, and traditions. It was only temporary, however, because about a decade after Pope's death, the Spanish returned and reconquered the land. When the United States expanded to the South and West, it took over Spanish territory in Florida and the Southwest. Most of the Spanish missions were abandoned when Spanish lands came under control of the government of the United States. But a few of them still operate today, and many can still be visited. If you live in the Southwest or can travel there, you can visit a historic mission yourself.